I'm Julie Lyles Carr, and this is the Modern Motherhood Podcast from All Mom Does. Millions of people tuned in to watch their wedding on the reality show Little People, Big World. But for Jeremy and Audrey Roloff, that wedding episode was just a brief snapshot of their journey to marriage and the intentionality they are bringing to their relationship to beat the 50% divorce rate in this country. Today, Audrey joins me to give insight to their story, their intentions, and where life and faith is leading them in their love letter life. Audrey, thanks so much for being with us.
Yeah, thanks for having me. This is going to be fun.
I think a lot of our listeners probably know, or at least are like, I know that name. So tell us how listeners would probably know you.
Okay. So the most likely way is my husband grew up on a reality TV show called Little People, Big World. And so we were actually married on the show. Our wedding was nationally televised. And then we did the show for 5 years of our marriage, and we actually just stepped away in the past year to focus on some other things. So that's probably the main way that you would know me, but we dabble a lot in the internet online space and do a lot of things there. So if you're a more recent follower in the past 5 years, you might be more familiar with some of those things, but yeah,
from there. Yeah. So what was it like marrying into a situation, a brand that was already rolling? Because, you know, a lot of couples, they're coming into a situation where they're trying to figure out how they're going to be a family. And but you're walking into something that is so firmly established. And I know other marriages, if somebody marries into like a family business that's really rolling or something of that. I mean, what was that like trying to come into a new identity? Yeah. And yet there was already an identity that was so well established.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. And we had to be super intentional about we are our own family now. And what do we want that family to look like and leave and cleave? You know, like even though there was this established brand, we were still working with Jared's parents in a way and his family. And we needed to respect that. But at the same time, like we needed to be intentional about like setting boundaries for us and like the differences that were going to be true to our marriage that aren't true to his parents and maybe some of his siblings that were married that are also on the show. So we had lots of honest conversations about that before I started to be on the show, and then especially surrounding our wedding, just because that's such a big day in a woman's life. And so for me, kind of protecting that, and we just were really honest with each other about that, you know, all the way through. You kind of have to be.
What were some of the expectations? You talk about the wedding.
Yeah.
I mean, and again, if you're in the entertainment industry, there are a lot of things that are going to be placed on you, a lot of expectations by a production company. So how did you handle that? Making sure that that day was truly about you guys. And at the same time, I mean, you're marrying into this experience of this reality show.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, I think I've always had a heart for being vulnerable with people. And if they can learn from my failures or from my vulnerabilities, then amazing. And sharing story and all of that. So we talk about this in our book, but we went back and forth a lot with the decision to film our wedding or not. We like to say like it was a decision whether to invite 200 people or 2 million people.
Right.
And so we really went back and forth with that a lot because we really wanted to protect the day. We wanted it to be intimate. And so kind of the same thing, we had to set certain parameters like, okay, film crew, you're only going to be in the room getting ready with my bridesmaids for X amount of hours, and you're going to leave after the ceremony. Like, you're only going to stay for like an hour at the reception for the toast, and then you're going to leave so we can have our party. And like, so there were things that we set in place to like sort of protect that day and sort of make it feel not like a production, because I was really worried, you know, my family and friends coming not from TV, not really ever having been around that, and all of a sudden they're showing up to my wedding and I have to sign a release that they're gonna it just feels a little bit like TSA to your wedding.
Exactly.
I don't really like this.
Check your pockets, take your shoes off.
And so I wanted to really protect that, and so we just did a lot of like very specific intentional things to make sure that like it still felt like, you know, we didn't have all the producers wear black that day. And like, so it wasn't as so intimidating. We put them in this corner with their tent and like, that was it. And then there was no redoing anything. It was all just, you can capture the day as it is. And we took communion and we had a first look, and those things were not filmed and not on the show. Two things that we kind of kept private for just us. So at the end of the day, I think the Lord was really able to be glorified through our wedding. And we were able to share so much of our love story for millions of people to see. And ultimately, that's a huge part of the reason why we were able to write this book. So in hindsight, I wouldn't change anything. It had its own challenges, but it was still a good thing at the end of the day, and a fun experience and something I can show my kids.
Yeah, so. You're going to have great footage from the wedding.
Yeah, right.
You guys were already doing like the really high-end wedding video before we had, it came like, thing.
Yeah, that wedding video and then this wedding video. Yeah. And it was so much like that.
Two different things.
Yeah.
So, but you know what all this tells me about you, Audrey, that I think is really interesting? You must have had a really strong sense of identity and who you are to walk into that situation and appropriately gate certain things, be really savvy about what to keep private and then what should be public. Mm-hmm. What do you attribute that to? Because I know a lot of young women who might walk into something like that, and I've interviewed others and have friends, you know, who have walked into sort of celebrity marriages, and it's been really hard for them to really know how to create those margins. So what do you think it was in you that allowed you to have that kind of wisdom walking in?
The first thing I would say is I would just attribute a lot of that to my husband. Like, he's just stayed so grounded and not caught up in, he could have been a completely different man than he is today and was because of the way that he was raised. 16 years raised on TV, you know, when reality TV wasn't really a thing. It was like Survivor and The Bachelor and Little and People,
the big world. Yeah.
And then the Duggars. So it was like, you know, I attribute a lot of that to him. Just he guided me into it in a very delicate way. So him for sure. And then definitely, I mean, for me, my personality, I don't know what you know about like the Enneagram.
Oh yeah, baby. I'm all over it.
I'm an eight.
Okay. Okay.
So I'm like, I don't have a problem with conflict.
Okay.
Which can be a blessing and a curse sometimes. But for me, I'm not afraid to stand my ground and I'm a challenger. And so I pushed back on certain things. I wasn't going to get walked all over by that entertainment industry. And at the end of the day, like, they did respect us really well and they wanted it to be a good experience for us. They weren't like out to get us,
right,
you know?
Right.
But sometimes I feel a little bit like they're out to get me because that's the eight in me. But I wasn't afraid to like take a stance for the things that were important to me and communicate those, even if there was a little like back and forth about it. And I think a lot of that is just, you know, kind of my personality.
Well, I think that's awesome. I think it's really encouraging because, you know, I know a lot of women who still really wrestle with the ability to say, hey, I'm not comfortable with this or this is the line. And there are arguments that a lot of times in our culture, women are sometimes trained to be the ones to be a little bit more, oh, you know, I don't want anybody to think I'm that kind of a girl or I'm this or that or the other. So I think it's really inspiring to hear that even walking into a situation which was totally fresh, you were able to really set some guidelines. And I think that really is a major thing. It's part of what I think gives you a lot of efficacy in terms of being able to speak into other marriages, because it sounds like to me you started in such a grounded place about what was going to be you and Jeremy and no one else. And a lot of couples don't start there. Now, at the beginning of your marriage, in addition to having this, you know, bonus round of your young marriage on TV in front of people, there was also a lot that was going on in, you know, one of the marriages around you that was, that could have been a mentor marriage to you and yet was undergoing its own struggles. So how did you navigate that as a young marriage going, well, here are some people we should naturally be looking to, and yet they're having to travel their own journey at this point, and it's a rugged one.
Yeah. You know, I mean, that was a hard thing, definitely for Jared. Just the timing of it all was just really hard on us, you know, specifically on Jeremy. But at the same time, we had lots of other mentor type couples come around us during that time that really poured into us and were a really good example of a godly marriage. And we were very fortunate in that. And I think a lot of that fueled the fire for what we do today, because we just, it's kind of like our overflow. So many people poured into us all this wisdom and told us these truths and really set us up for marriage. One of the things we always say is like, you should be preparing more for your marriage than your wedding day.
Yeah.
And so many people in our generation, it's like, well, the wedding is the thing. And you, when you meet someone that's engaged, the first thing you say is, well, how's wedding planning going? But do you say, well, how's marriage planning going?
Yeah.
You know what
I
mean? And it's like, well, we should be preparing for this thing that's going to be the rest of our life. So we had these people that were really pouring into us, our premarital counselors and a couple other couples. Jeremy's grandparents, my parents have been married for 26 years. So on the one hand, it's heartbreaking and hard. But on the other hand, like, Jared's parents were still a good voice up for a lot of other things us during that season. It wasn't that we like couldn't learn from them, even though they were going through this really hard thing.
You and Jeremy have been given a lot of access into the marriage space with the work that you're doing and a lot of great things that you have going on. What do you think it is that we are seeing, for example, promposals that are like the most extravagant, and you're talking about a one night prom, right? But like the most extravagant thing, homecoming proposals, all the way to proposals and these weddings that are just unbelievable.
Yeah.
And And yet you're right. There's not a lot of training going into wedding, to marriage. There's a lot of prep going into wedding. What do you think that is? Are we a culture that is just more fascinated a little bit in only creating moments without thinking about investment underneath? What do you see?
I definitely agree with that statement. I think the moments thing, you just look at social media alone, like all those curated moments for the photo or the thing or whatever, when what's really going on behind the scenes, I definitely think like we're such a like fast, immediacy culture. Like we have to get everything now. Everything is urgent. And I just think investing in those long-term things, the time it takes to like talk about some of the things that would help prepare you for marriage, it's an investment. And it's also like emotionally taxing and mentally exhausting. But to talk about those things and prepare yourself for marriage and set those boundaries and communicate, past hurts or whatever it might be, can really set you up for the long term. And I think a lot of times we're just so focused on like, what's the urgent thing? Planning the wedding, doing that we forget to do the important thing. It's like, I remember when I was a kid, my mom drew me the boxes and it's like, here's urgent, important. I forget what the other ones were. And it's like, you always neglect that important category because you do urgent things, and you just get so bombarded with those things. And so, I think that's something that Jeremy and I have just been really intentional about, kind of like in our lives as individuals, but also since we've been married, just really like preparing for the next step. What intentional things can we do? What boundaries can we put in place to just like be more intentional in that step so that we have a reserve to pull on once we get there?
Once you get there.
You
guys made a really interesting decision a few years ago after this televised wedding and being, welcomed into this television family experience. You decided to walk away. Mm-hmm. And in a very branded, how many followers can we gather? And, we're in an industry when it comes to publishing and things like that those schematics are important when it comes to getting the next book deal, all of that. And also, you guys have such an entrepreneurial spirit. So, you're in the online space, you have different products that you're selling, that kind of thing. How did you make that decision to walk away from what a lot of people would be a slam dunk when it comes to having that platform that's already built and there for you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So a couple of things. The first is kind of like we talked about in the beginning, like it was Jeremy's family's
thing,
show
and
thing. And we kind of were a part of it and we got to share our lives on it, but it wasn't like our thing really. Mm-hmm. And Jeremy never wanted, he says like, I never set out to be a reality TV star, like that wasn't, and it is time consuming. And it was such a blessing for us. It gave us the platforms and the ability to do what we do now. And I'm very, very grateful for that. But it also like kind of restricted us in some ways, timing being one of the hugest reasons, but also just like, contractually, we weren't able to like pursue some of the things that we wanted to do because of our commitment to the show at the time. And so we have both of us a passion for writing, and we had some other ideas and things of that we wanted to do and launch that we weren't able to at the time. And so we just really started thinking. And then once we got pregnant with our daughter, we were like, Jeremy was like, I don't want to raise my kids in this way. And so we just decided our time was up. Jeremy had been doing it for 16 years. That's a long time to do something. Yeah, yeah. And he was just kind of like, you know what? Like, I'm ready to move on.
There it was.
So
what was that transition like to go from cameras and a lot of controlled schedule and all of that to now it's you guys and there's no net?
I think it was, honestly, for us, it was very freeing. We were really ready at the time. We had been kind of sort of like building our lifeboats, like we like to say. And we were just really ready. It was emotionally just a hard thing on our relationship, on our marriage. And we were just ready to like move on to new things. And so honestly, for us, there was no sense of like, I don't know, what did we do? We were like very confident in the decision, and we were just like, we were very aligned in it, and just we felt peace, like when you make the right decision and the Lord just like gives you that peace. Like for us, that's totally what we experienced. And then we just got really excited about the time that we now had to like pursue the things that we really wanted to do and give our all to those things that we were kind of like havesying, for a while.
I'm really passionate about. We'll be back in a minute with more from Audrey, but first, check out how you can help end child trafficking through World Concern. Over 1 million. That's the number. Over 1 million children are trafficked in the world's poorest places, and that number can sound really overwhelming, but there is something you can do to help. On May 11th, join World Concern for the SOS 5K in Seattle. You and your family can run for a cause, whether that's actually hitting the pavement with us or by donating to help stop child trafficking worldwide. The SOS 5K is a number that can help end the number of over 1 million children who are trafficked. Go to SOS5K.org to register or to donate today. That's the World Concern SOS 5K in Seattle, Washington, May 11th. Make a difference by going to SOS5K.org. Now, how did you know that the marriage lane was going to be the lane? Because there could be people who would argue, well, you guys have been married a hot minute. Like, you know, are you going to be able to speak into other marriages? And how did you know that was the call? And how did you know that you had something to offer in that lane? When, you know, I do think about in the word where, you know, Paul's telling Timothy, don't let anybody put you down because you're young, you know. I'm all in. Totally. I'm like, absolutely. I want to hear younger voices in this space. I think it's super important. But I also understand why people would be like, yeah, give it 20 years and then we'll see.
Right.
So how did you know that marriage was the call, and how did you have the confidence to step into that, given that you were younger and hadn't been married a long time?
Well, first thing, I don't even know if it is our lane. I don't even know if it is our, I think calling is a big scary word.
Yeah, it is.
I might be called to a lot of things. I think it was the thing at the time that we were the most passionate about, that people ask us about the most. I think after our wedding, like, so many people would email me these questions, like, about things that I said in my vows or things that we did, and asking me these marriage questions, and I was forwarding them to my mom. I'm like, what? I don't know what to say to the, you know what I mean? But we just realized kind of like, well, like, we can just share what we're learning along our journey and invite people into that in the same way that we did with TV. Like, let's just invite people in and share them what we're learning from our failures and our successes. And from, like I said earlier, the people that were pouring into us, just sharing their wisdom. People that, you know, maybe don't have a platform, but have all this rich wisdom. And so a lot of our marriage ministry and blog is that. A lot of it, we, you know, we have other older writers too. It's not just us. But I will say, like, I don't know that it will be our lane forever. I think we've built this mission. We're very passionate about it and we love relationships, but there's also a lot of other passions in us and things that we, you know, want to share, speak to, or write about. And so, I think that's kind of the nature of entrepreneurship too. Like, it ebbs and flows. And so whenever people say like calling, I'm like, I don't know. Like, I think that there's certain gifts and talents and things that the Lord has given us. And I think there's certain things maybe that he's purposed me to do that are a little bit more specific, but I think they can change as life changes. And I think that kind of takes the pressure off a little bit too.
No, I love that. Yeah, I think I so often we think we have to find the one thing.
Right. It's like,
and we've got to, you know.
Then you don't do anything because you're just waiting for what that one thing is.
Right.
And we were just at the time like, well, this thing seems like a good thing. Let's start here.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And so that's kind of what we did. And, you know, I think now, like, as we go through the different seasons of life, we're probably going to talk more about running a business together. We're going to talk more about parenting and having children. You know what I mean? Right. Just as the things go. But really, just I think a huge heart behind everything that we do is just honesty, being honest and vulnerable, but also just like helping people be more intentional with kind of like what I said before about like preparing for the next step. But just being more intentional with their lives, more intentional with their love stories, more intentional with parenting, more intentional in their marriage, you know, more intentional in running a business or working a job or whatever, in your friendships, whatever it is. That's a huge thing for us. Finding creative ways to help people do that and sharing those is like a huge heart. So
what does intentionality mean to you? Because that's a really big term. And I love that term. I know what it means to me.
Yeah.
But sometimes I think we can grab onto these buzzwords and we don't intend for this to happen, but they almost become muted or they almost become less effective because we don't exactly unpack what they mean. So what does intentionality mean to you and Jeremy?
Yeah. Jeremy wrote me letters, handwritten letters when we were in long distance. And that was a very intentional thing. It took creativity. It was a specific gesture that he did that was effortful, like writing a handwritten letter. It's different than a text message or a Skype call or whatever. So I think intentionality, a lot of it comes from being creative, specific, and it's effort. You know, it's time. I think just not living flippantly, being mindful about like what you're saying yes to, what you're saying no to. Like, creativity is what comes to mind for me, because I think like it takes creativity and extra effort to think about those ways that you are going to be intentional, you know?
Right.
And so I think for us, like, yeah, that's just been like such a huge part of our story and our life and something that we're really passionate about. And
I love that you bring up love letters, because you know, we lost my father-in-law, whom we are just, was the sweetest man I ever knew, truly. Aww. We lost him in 16, and then we lost my mother-in-law very suddenly in 18. And it was just very, it was all very fast. I mean, it was very stunning to us. And as I was going through their house a few months ago after my mother-in-law passed, you know, one of the things that we came across were my father-in-law's love letters to my mother-in-law when they were dating.
That's amazing.
And that window on him and that window on their relationship and that window on how he saw her. And that I'm telling you, of all the stuff I hauled home, those are the things that are the most precious. And my kids, their grandchildren, sat down and more than anything I could have told them about what I think about marriage or about their grandparents' relationship or anything else, those letters spoke more and have set a standard for my kids in a way. So when you talk about, you know, this, a love letter life, when you talk about the love letters that, that Jeremy was writing to you, you know, you're also talking legacy because your marriage can speak forward even when you're gone. Mm-hmm. And I think that that is such a powerful, you know, it's a metaphor, but it's also a real thing to sit down and write that.
Right.
I mean, so, so tell me about the genesis of this book, because you and I'm coining a new phrase. I'm going to call us editor sisters because we have the same acquisitions editor at Zondervan, mine for my first book and y'all for this book, Carolyn McCready. We love you, Carolyn.
We love you.
So tell me the process of writing this book, how, because you had the blog, it was doing really well. You have a marriage journal that's available. It was doing great. And now you're launching into going into publishing in a book. How did that process begin for you?
Yeah. So really, this is like a big dream for me. I've loved writing my whole life. I've been a journaler, you know, like I got the closet full of all of the journals. And I had a blog in college that I just kind of wrote on and shared my life. And running was a huge part of it because I was a distance runner in college. So I wrote a lot about like running and faith. And so for me, I always wanted to write a book. And I wasn't sure like what that was, but a couple years ago, we had a book agent reach out to us, and that's not super common in the publishing world that a book agent reaches out to you.
Usually you're chasing them.
So I didn't think anything of it. I just thought like, this is a scam, or I just didn't think it was legit. And he reached out multiple times over the course of a few months. Finally, we had a friend who was previously in agenting, and we asked, like, do you know this guy? And he's like, you should probably reply to that. And so I did, and thinking like, oh, maybe we can start this conversation in like a 10-year from now thing will transpire.
Maybe eventually,
And anyways, he ended up being like one of the best things that's happened to our career. He's amazing, Brian Norman, and we just love him, adore him. And he was like, well, you guys have a book in you now. And we just kind of started talking to him about like our ideas and things that we're passionate about. And he's like, people are going to eat that up.
Right.
And we were like, oh, well, you know, like we didn't, kind of what we were saying earlier, we were like, well, do we really want to brand ourselves as marriage? Do we really want that to be our first book? You know, are we too young? Should we wait? Should it be something else first? Should it be just me or just Jeremy? We had all these other ideas of things, you know, and this one just really rose to the surface and seemed like the most timely and the thing that we were the most passionate about at the time. And it's essentially our love story from our first date to our wedding day. But we kind of like, we like to say it's like This Is Us-esque, you know, the TV show.
Yeah.
So we flash forward in our marriage and like share something that we're learning in our marriage now and then flash back to like dating and then flash forward. And so it's kind of like, we think that people that are married can still find some takeaways and be inspired by the story. It's not just for like dating couples, but there is a huge element of, you know, helping people to prepare more for their marriage than their wedding day and how we did that and how we failed at that. And so that's a huge part of it. But yeah, the letter writing was why we called it A Love Letter Life, because just the extra intentionality effort that goes into a handwritten letter is kind of what we wanted our love story to be about. That extra effort, that extra care.
I love it. Well, how is it working together to write this book? Because my husband and I speak together frequently and we've done some stuff on marriage, and sometimes some of our biggest wars have been right before we've walked out to speak on marriage. And, you know, some people look at me and go, well, then you shouldn't walk out and speak on marriage. I'm like, well, no, I think that's exactly why we should go out there. But, you know, speak to that. I mean, this process of learning to work with another person, because you'd already had this dream of writing. This was something you'd already had before you met Jeremy. And when you are trying to collaborate on something and do life together and parent together, and now you're working together, what is that like?
Yeah. So first I would say, like, I wouldn't change it for the world. I absolutely love working with him. It's so fun that we get to do what we do together, and our date nights can consist of dreaming up new ideas and things that we're going to do, and that we get each other's world so well.
Right.
It's like such a blessing. And so I love that. We always kind of wanted that, even when we were dating and had no idea, you know, what we'd be doing, what we're doing now. We had corporate jobs when we first got married, but we always kind of craved that. And so on the one hand, I think we're super grateful for it. We don't take it for granted. We love it. On the other hand, it's very hard. It comes with a lot of challenges, I'm sure you know. And it's also hard to find other people that are in the same space that can speak into that.
Right.
We've had a hard time with that, like finding community around us that kind of like gets what we do, or gets our struggles, that can like guide us in them.
Right.
And so like that's been a challenge. But I would say, like, for the most part, Jeremy and I, like, we balance each other really well. We have different strengths and different weaknesses, and we kind of fill the gaps for each other.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a really good thing for us working together. I'd say the hardest part for us is just that we tend to overwork, and we tend to go into this mode of just treating each other as coworkers all day long instead of as husband and wife. And so I foresee that being a problem, and we're trying to set some boundaries and rhythms in place in our marriage so that that doesn't become something that wreaks havoc on our marriage.
I think that's really smart. I mean, I think Mike and I have experienced that when you are great as business partners,
mm-hmm.
but it's so hard to take that hat off.
Right. So how did you guys do that?
In many ways, I think we're still navigating it. Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, he, you know, so we do a lot of things together, but he also works
separate
because he's in financial services and does that full time. And then he jumps into my world and does stuff with me in the ministry lane and speaking and things of that nature. And I think we're still learning to navigate that. I think there are times, you know, as you're saying with you and Jeremy, there are times we do it really well. There are times that, you know, we're a disaster.
Yeah.
I think part of it is the recognition that it actually is a big component of the marriage. It is part of the chemistry within the marriage, but it can't be all of the marriage. And I think that distinction has been really important, because we click so well in some of those areas that it can be easy to sort of neglect the areas where we do have to work a little bit harder to see each other's side of things and to navigate well. And so sometimes you tend to only want to do the stuff that you're good at together as a couple, and you neglect what's going on that's harder.
Mm-hmm.
And so to really stay mindful that that lane is still there and still has to be weeded and pruned nicely.
Yeah. No, that's good. I'm going to take that back. That's good. I mean, yeah, we definitely are in that season right now. I mean, you know, with all the work that goes into publishing a book and also trying to keep our other things afloat and having a 16-month-old.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, we're definitely wading those waters and trying to figure out what that looks like. And, you know, how can we have sometimes where we don't talk about work, or turning off our phones at 10 p.m. or not having our phones in bed ever, like certain things that we're getting better at. Like, okay, Sunday's our Sabbath. We're not going to be on social media. That way we know that if we're on our phone, it's like to check a text message from someone that we're about to go have dinner with. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because I think that can be such a thing. I mean, I don't know if you guys, I'd be curious to hear if you guys have parameters or things for phone use, because when you're working from home with your husband, the phone thing do you manage that?
It's your office.
Because for me, I know sometimes it can be an excuse, but 90% of the time I'm working on my phone.
Exactly.
And so is Jeremy. But then it's this thing where we're like together, but we're just on our phones, which is kind of like being on your computers, working in an office, but then it just does something.
Yeah.
It just creates this energy that's not,
It's a strange, you know, one of the things that we've done, and this started maybe 3-4 years ago, and it wasn't because I had some like phenomenal insight. It was that I had allowed things to get so bad in my own head, because I can live in my own head so much. And I realized, you know what? We need to stop talking about work at about 8 o'clock at night. If nothing, like, we just can't bring it up anymore. Mm. And it was for my benefit. Mm. I wasn't even thinking marriage, because I was just thinking, I know what I'm doing. I know if we start talking about this at 10:30, I'm going to go, you know what? I should just jump on real fast just put that email, or just make sure that got taken care of. Or I'm going to turn over and over in my mind that this is a problem that now needs to be solved. And at 2 a.m. when he's sleeping really good, because that man, I'm telling you, has the gift of being able to deal with like a major, major issue. And then like, I'm going to bed. Good night.
That's Jeremy.
And I'm
my husband.
What?
Oh my gosh. Totally
what?
Jeremy. Whereas I will sit there all night.
All night long, baby. All night long.
Yeah.
So we just naturally, because I was hitting a place of just, you know, I just let it get too overwhelming that we started shutting down those conversations. Mm-hmm. But the fruit I started seeing from it. Yeah. Well, then if we can't talk about work, then we need to talk about other things. And of course, you guys are in the lane too now with Ember, that then you naturally gravitate toward talking about parenting. Mm-hmm. But thankfully, one of the things that we started early in our marriage, and I don't know why, but I always thought it was so important to laugh at night before you go to sleep.
So good.
You know, sometimes even if we're on phones, we're not doing as good a job as y'all are about saying, okay, no phones after a certain time. Part of it, we've got teenagers who are around. We've got to keep the text
message. Manage them.
Yeah. Can you text me $10 for gas? I mean, like, you know, this kind of thing. But if we will just sit and laugh with each other, even if we're just laughing at the same memes, at least we're having that shared experience of laughing. And I realize it doesn't sound super spiritual. It doesn't sound like a great. Gosh. But to just even change the context of the content that you're consuming.
Yes.
And being intentional about that at a certain time in the evening, I think can really help shift that gear. At least it does for me.
And just that you guys are having that shared experience together. You are getting each other's work. Because, like, you know, like how people watch couples, like, we have a lot of friends who they watch different shows. The wife watches these shows.
And he watches that one. And
And it's like, then you don't have, I don't know. We have a chapter in our book. It's called The Principle of Sharing. And it's basically this concept that, like, if your husband or wife loves something, or the person that you love loves something, there must be something to love about it.
Right.
If they
right.
love something, there must be something to love about it. And so, like, we sort of abide to this thing where I love running. Jeremy hates it. But there must be something to love running.
Same. We've got the same.
He ran a half marathon for me.
Like, that's amazing. Literally.
And then, like, on the flip side, like, I don't care about soccer. He loves soccer.
Girlfriend.
So, like, I had to learn to watch the World Cup.
We are living the same life. I didn't know. I'm a runner. Mike is not.
I love it.
Mike adores soccer.
Okay,
crazy about soccer. I find it the perfect medium to nap to.
Yep.
So, I mean, that is amazing.
Goal. Yeah. I'm like, no, thank you.
But it is learning to take someone's joy in it. Right. And you know, Mike's been super involved in our community because there's a professional team coming, and he's been down at city council meetings and all kinds of stuff. And I'm like,
that's right. I heard that.
Been a whole thing here in Austin. But you're right. I mean, to be willing to love it for him. Mm-hmm. And I don't go as often as I should, but I have learned, and I will sit and I will get into certain things. And you know what we have found is actually the place that we can really compromise? Rugby. You guys might want to try out rugby.
That's so funny. Like, I would never
think of it. It's like American football and soccer together, kind of all mashed up. Yeah. And you know, it's a place where we've been able to share.
That's so funny.
But you're right. I do think being willing to share each other's passions, even if you don't totally get it, is a huge one.
And even like books and shows. And I mean, not to the weird extent. Like, obviously you're not going to read everything or watch everything the same. But just like, you know, my favorite books are a book that's really impacted me. Jer reads it. If a book really impacted Jer and changed the way he thought about something, I'm going to read it.
Right.
You know?
Because those things are shaping. And you know, we talk a lot about, you know, that diet is nutrition, what you're eating. But it's, you know, we see little memes like this. I mean, it's everything you're taking in.
Yeah.
And if you're not sharing that, if you don't know, then how are you going to be able to continue to grow more and more toward one another if you're growing in completely different ways?
Yeah.
Now, you've also had, so, you know, you have this wedding that's on television. You walk away from that. You have these entrepreneurial things going on. You have the book going on. And in the middle of all this, you get to have one of the most marriage-altering experiences ever, which is, let's have a baby.
Yes.
So what has that experience been in your marriage, and how has it changed that?
Yes. So Ember, our first daughter, she was a surprise.
Mm-hmm. Got one of those?
Yes.
A couple, three.
So we were like, oh my goodness. Okay, here we go.
Yep.
But yes, so I would say, like, honestly, it's been so far like a really, she's been a good baby. I think we've been very fortunate. She's a good sleeper. The beginning was really hard for me. I struggled a lot. I had mastitis 5 times and like, I'm sure you know these things. She had like just a bunch of problems breastfeeding, and I fractured my tailbone in labor, and like, it was just a hot mess. And then at the time we had to start writing our book when she was 2 months old. We had to start writing it because the manuscript was here.
You could form sentences. Okay. I'm impressed.
Yeah, no, my mom brain. I would write things and I'd be like, I just completely forgot what I was saying. But but it just really, for us, it gave us kind of a season of like 2 to 3 months of calm. Mm-hmm. I know that sounds crazy, but we just kind of shut down a lot of the stuff that we were doing. We had to, in a lot of ways. I was sick and so in pain and just figuring that out, and we were sleep deprived. And I think honestly, like looking back, that season was really hard, but super, super sweet for our marriage, because we weren't trying to keep all the other things that we were doing afloat. We just kind of like surrendered and said like, you know what? We're not going to do always more customer service, and we're not going to do beating 50 blogs, and it's okay. It's all you know right. what? It's
yeah.
okay.
Yeah.
And we also surrendered some control to some people and brought on some more help, mm-hmm. which was a really good thing for us and a learning experience. That chunk of like the newborn phase was like really sweet, really hard physically, but like really sweet for our marriage. And then we got into like when she started moving.
Yeah.
yeah. and now we're like, okay, we can't just get 5 hours of work time in while she lays on the floor.
Right. You know? Right.
Now it's like, okay, well, what are we going to do? Who's going to watch her? How many days
who's
a week?
Who's on call?
Yeah. Because just because you work at home doesn't mean you don't need a nanny. Yep, like, exactly. How are you going to do that? And so we're just now really starting to figure all of that out. And like, what does traveling look like? Who's going to watch her? And
right.
She's such a joy. Like, we love her so much. And we've always had a heart to have a big family. Mm-hmm. And so we definitely want more after this book tour.
yeah. I would say you've had two babies.
Yeah, you know, right?
Because
exactly.
I've said it's that the crazy. Process of writing for whatever, I mean, it really to me did feel very much like a pregnancy yes. and birthing.
It's
I mean,
just it was, as yeah, long or
it
longer.
Is, or longer. I know, longer.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, well, I'm glad that you're finding ways to navigate that. And I think that will then, you know, as we talked about earlier, that willingness to say, well, yeah, this is what we're speaking into right now, but we feel like God could then ask us to do this or that or the other. I think for people to take that journey with you, particularly in an entrepreneurial marriage where you are working together and providing for this little girl that you're so crazy about. You know, there aren't a lot of models out there in some ways
that's
for
totally
people to look to. And so we've had to navigate in some interesting ways and try to figure it out. And you guys will too. And I think that that's going to be hugely important for the people that are in your community that you're speaking into their lives.
Yeah.
So what are some of the next projects that you've got on the horizon? Because I can tell you're a visionary. You're a girl on fire. I can tell.
Always thinking about the next thing.
Yeah, what's the next thing?
So, you know, there's some more books coming.
Yeah, okay, good.
We'll just leave it at that.
Yeah.
So we just launched a podcast recently.
Awesome.
And so that's been, it's still pretty fresh. It's only been a couple months. And so that's been really, really fun. Honestly, like probably the most fun thing we've done together because it's such a just conversational, real, we called our podcast Behind the Scenes, literally.
Right.
So it's like we go behind the scenes with other people and then we do the behind the scenes of our life. But it just is very natural for us. We can talk about like whatever God's teaching us, whatever we're learning. So that's been super fun.
Well,
so,
you've got a clothing line.
Yeah. The clothing line, we just actually hired our first full-time employee. And so we're really excited about that because it's going to just help us grow and scale and meet some needs that we haven't been able to for a while that we've been wanting to for a long time. And so we have some just exciting things coming with Always More, the clothing line, and turning that into more of a movement and kind of like restructuring that model. And so some cool things going there. I guess I'll leave it at that. I don't want to like say too much, but like, I'm like, oh, I don't know exactly. More babies, hopefully.
And yeah.
We're also looking forward to just like, we're going to try to take a month break after this book tour just to like a month Sabbath, like a sabbatical, like they used to do.
Right.
And now
it's
like not a thing that anybody does anymore, but we should probably.
Yeah.
So we're going to try to do that for a month, go away. We did it last year for 3 weeks right after we finished writing the book. We went to Maui. And so we're going to try to do that again, just downtime, try to literally unplug, log out of social media, not have it on our phones, and just like 3 weeks to a month of just rest. Because we live in this world where it's like we have these intense seasons and then we need intense rest to balance it.
Right.
Like we need to go to that opposite extreme. And that's, or for me at least, like I really do need to go to that opposite extreme. And so that's something I'm looking forward to too.
Right.
So.
And I think learning to embrace that about yourself. I mean, I'm wired very, well, exactly the same way. I mean, like I will go 100 miles an hour for quite a while and then I have to completely stop. And it's discombobulating for some people around me because they assume it's 100 miles an hour
always,
the time.
Yeah.
But I do think I've learned, and I think it's so cool that you already know this about yourself and you embrace it at this season of your life and your mothering and your career and your marriage. You know, if you're wired that way, give yourself permission to do that.
Yes.
Like just embrace that. And if you're not wired that way, if you're someone who can just kind of keep it a steady pace, but you feel like you're not accomplishing as much as some of us who are 100 mile an hour people.
Right.
Hey, and it all comes out in the wash. It all works.
Yeah.
But I think it's great that you embrace that. So excited about other Roloff baby, a love letter life.
The second child.
Exactly. Well, Audrey, thanks so much for being with us today.
Much.
I know our listeners are going to be so blessed.
Oh, thank you.
Connect with Audrey at Instagram at Audrey Roloff and with Jeremy too at Jeremy Roloff. And be sure and check out the book that's just been released, A Love Letter Life. I'd love to connect with you too. I'm Julie Lyles Carr at All the Places Social. Big thanks to Donna Todi, our amazing producer, and Rebecca Beckett, our content coordinator. And do me a favor to help thank them for getting the podcast out each and every week. Leave us a 5-star rating and review wherever you get your podcasts. It really does help others find the podcast, and we might just feature your review in an upcoming episode. Be sure and check out allmomdoes.com and allmomdoes on the socials. It's a fantastic community of support and ideas and inspiration for the life you lead, with the kids you're raising, with your romantic relationship, for the work that you're doing. I'll see you next time on the Modern Motherhood Podcast.